Good morning. I'm Asan Giordano, and this is your DMV Daily Dose for Monday, January 20th, 2020.
It's currently clear and 23 degrees in Baltimore. Today's high will be 33 degrees, and the low will be 23.
Well, the Super Bowl in Miami, Florida, scheduled for 2 weeks, has been set as the San Francisco 49ers easily dismantled the Aaron Rodgers-led Green Bay Packers, while the Kansas City Chiefs were led by their Lamar Jackson wannabe quarterback, Patrick Mahomes, as they disposed of the team that knocked out the Ravens just last week, the Tennessee Titans, and it made it to their first Super Bowl in the past 50 years. So it will be the Chiefs versus the 49ers who look to claim that crown on Sunday, February 2nd. And it should be us, but we'll be back next year. Big trust. And after the State Central Committee debacle that we have reported on extensively here on the DMV Daily Dose, it appears that the election of the 45th District Central Committee Chair, Chanel Branch, to fill the vacant 45th District State Delegate seat has revived the debate about the way the General Assembly vacancies are filled and whether the process does enough to consider voters' voices. Since 2016, roughly 24 state legislators have been appointed in Annapolis without ever being elected, while Branch, who is the daughter of the district's longest-serving state delegate, awaits a decision by Maryland Governor Larry Hogan on whether he will appoint her to the vacant delegate seat that she happened to win just a few weeks ago by voting for herself. State lawmakers have introduced legislation this session that they say would make the process more democratic, according to the Baltimore Sun's Talia Richmond. Under a bill introduced by State Senator Clarence Lamb, central committees would still appoint people to fill empty seats. But instead of allowing the appointee to carry out the rest of the term, there would be a special election in that district held at the same time as the next regularly scheduled statewide election, typically every 2 years. This move would, in most cases, limit the amount of time an appointed lawmaker could hold on to their seat, and he said, make them more accountable to their constituents. Quote, it's really an accountability measure to make sure voters have a say in who is representing them in the Maryland General Assembly, Lamb said. Going through an election is the best way for an elected official to get to know their district so that they can represent their views. Delegate David Moon, a Democrat from Montgomery County, introduced a version of the legislation in the House. He says he's been trying to do so since he joined the House of Delegates in 2015 to reform the way vacancies are filled in the Maryland General Assembly. Originally, he wanted to require district special elections for vacancies, like what we will see on February 4th in the 7th District, to replace the late former Congressman Elijah Cummings. But Moon said that his idea was met with strong resistance. There were concerns about the cost of administering multiple special elections and low voter turnout for elections that had only one race on the ballot. This year's proposal is a compromise, he said, intended to quell those fears while also representing a vast improvement over the current system. Now, the change would be a constitutional amendment, so even if it passes the General Assembly, voters would need to approve it at the ballot box in November. Now, the Maryland Democratic Party also could take its own steps without requiring legislative action to change the rules surrounding this process. The party could simply prohibit, for example, a person from voting for themselves if they are seeking a nomination and a member of the State Central Committee, like Branch was. Now, the Afro was reporting on a story from Wesley Brown from the Capitol News Desk that state lawmakers heard arguments on a bill that seeks to add criminal penalties for knowingly possessing ransomware with the intent to use it in a malicious way. Now, ransomware is a type of malware that can impede the use of a computer or computer network indefinitely until a ransom is paid. It is already a crime in Maryland to use the malicious technology in a way that costs victims money. This bill, however, would criminalize mere possession of that software. Senate Bill 30 would label the possession and intent to use ransomware in a malicious manner as a misdemeanor that could carry a penalty of up to 10 years in prison and or a fine of $10,000. Most recently, as many of you may remember, Baltimore City had its own core computing system attacked in May of 2019 by the use of the Robinhood ransomware. And according to Mayor Bernard Jack Young's office, the city's budget office estimated the cost of that attack to be around $18 million, which includes the cost to restore or repair systems as well as lost or delayed revenues. Now, they are also reporting on legislation that would make Senate bills a hot commodity in Maryland if a rule proposed this week is enacted. The Senate Rules Committee is planning to meet on Friday to consider limiting the number of bills any one senator can propose in the 90-day legislative session of the state's General Assembly. Now, the bills have 40 bills this year. But Senator Michael Ho, a Republican from Frederick and Carroll County, wants to cut that number to no more than 20. He says that because we hear every bill in a committee, our time is taken up by legislation that has been defeated time and time again, or legislation that has little chance, or legislation that, quite frankly, has not been worked out all the way. Now, who said on the Senate floor that this bill is certainly needed, while newly selected Senate President Bill Ferguson didn't comment on the bill as to his support or lack thereof, merely appointing it to the Rules Committee, where he is also a member. However, Senate President Ferguson did sound rather optimistic, stating last week that, quote, time is our biggest constraint, so figuring out how we can be more efficient is no doubt an absolute priority moving forward. We appreciate the efforts that was brought forth by this legislation. Now, Ho said that he based the rule on one governing California state senators and similar rules he said existed in 23 other states. He said it would also save the state money spent on the legislative process, but not all senators think the change is needed. Maryland Matters was reporting on a growing group of Maryland lawmakers who are rallying behind a measure that would effectively give local government leaders veto power over state-backed toll road projects. Currently, the state must obtain the approval of a majority of impacted counties before building a toll road, bridge, or tunnel in the nine counties that comprise of the Eastern Shore, which include Caroline, Cecil, Dorchester, Kent, Queen Anne's, Somerset, Talbot, Wicomico, and Worcester counties. Now, Senate Bill 229 and House Bill 292 would expand that power to all of Maryland's 23 counties and the city of Baltimore. It's an equity issue, said Delegate Mary Lehman, a Democrat from Prince George's County. The law has been on the books for 42 years now. There should be a local review. The measure comes as the Hogan administration moves forward with plans to renovate and expand the American Legion Bridge and widen the westernmost portion of the Capitol Beltway and the southern portion of Interstate I-270. Now, the talk of the town this holiday weekend was, of course, the incident that sent ripples through the communities of Baltimore City, where one individual spat in the face of a Baltimore City police officer while others kicked the officer as he proceeded to arrest the individual responsible for spitting on him, setting off a firestorm of debate around the level of respect that citizens have for a group that has become public enemy number one in the city of Baltimore over the past few years, especially following the news and the arrest of the corrupt Gun Trace Task Force. Now, the Baltimore Sun is reporting this morning that Baltimore police say that they've arrested an adult and a teenager in connection with that assault on the city police officer that was captured on video, showing citizens kicking the officer while he was detaining another man. Donnell Burgess, 20 years old, was arrested Sunday and charged with assault on police and resisting arrest in relation to the January 17th incident. The department wrote in a news release that an unnamed 17-year-old was also arrested and charged as a juvenile. Now, a video was widely circulated on social media this weekend that showed the Baltimore City Police Sergeant being kicked by onlookers while he tried to restrain a man on the ground Friday night. Police Commissioner Michael Harrison said that the officer was doing a business check in the 1500 block of Pennsylvania Avenue around midnight when a person became argumentative and spat in the officer's face. The video showed the apparent aftermath of the attempted arrest, as several onlookers kick at the officer and at least one person attempts to drag the man away from the sergeant as he was trying to detain him. We will give you further updates on this incident as they become available. We want to say happy Martin Luther King Jr. Day. Don't forget later today that the MLK Day Parade will start at noon over at State Center, the corner of Martin Luther King Jr. Boulevard and Utah Street. You want to bundle up because it's a chilly one out there. And of course, tonight is the big night as the DMV Daily produced Value My Vote 2020 MLK Day Congressional Debate takes place starting at 5:30 p.m. Now, doors open to the Soul Harvest Baptist Church facility beginning at 5 o'clock, and tickets have been sold out for weeks now. But you can watch the debate, and the only debate for this hotly contested congressional race, on the DMV Daily News Facebook page beginning at 5:30 p.m. Just go to Facebook and put in DMV Daily News, all one word. It will be moderated by WOLB 1010 AM's morning show host, Larry Young, with special guest panelists including Luke Broadwater of the Baltimore Sun, Karen York from the Job Opportunities Task Force, Ricard Jones from the SEIU 1199, and of course, DMV Daily's own Ivan Bates Esquire from Bates and Garcia Law. Make sure that you tune in to this once-in-a-lifetime debate ahead of the February 4th special election, as candidates including Delegates Talmadge Branch and Terry Hill, Senator Jill Carter, former Congressman Kwaisi Mfume, former Maryland Democratic Party Chair Maya Rocky Moore Cummins, University of Baltimore Dean Michael Higginbotham, and area businessman Safia Robb all square off. I'm your man, Mr. Politics, and this has been your DMV Daily Dose for Monday, January 20th, 2020. For more information on the articles that I've mentioned, just go on over to our website at www.dmvdaily.news.